Well, good afternoon, and thank you all for joining us today. We'll start this afternoon's news conference with some encouraging news. Our rates of COVID-19 transmission in schools are steady. I want to personally thank, as a result, every teacher, every parent, every student, who are doing the work of wearing masks, keeping distant, and practicing good hygiene. It's paying off. I also want to thank our administrators and our school boards who are putting out consistent and reliable information to all affected parties when that information comes in. The start of the school year was always going to be one of our biggest challenges. And by most measures, we are succeeding thus far. Now, with fall break underway in much of Marion County, it is all the more critical for residents to double down on the responsible behavior that has allowed us to reopen our classrooms and in so doing, restore some sense of normalcy to the lives of our children. Transmission among school-aged children isn't the only metric that we are closely monitoring. Currently, Marion County's seven-day positivity rate is 5%. And while I know many are looking forward to the further relaxation of restrictions, for now, Marion County's current mitigation efforts will stay in place. While our numbers have not worsened, now is not the time to throw away all the hard work that we've been doing together and that we have put in place to get us to a position where the virus continues to recede incrementally. The spread of the virus, I mean, continues to recede steadily. I know that these restrictions are a hardship. We've said that many times before. I know that these restrictions are a nuisance. I know that so many residents are fatigued by the intrusion of COVID-19 into our lives. They're a hardship and they're a nuisance for individuals and businesses alike. But I want to encourage all residents, all neighborhoods, all community groups, all organizations to think carefully about the plans you have in place and have conversations about how you can remain diligent in all of your efforts. One such example, Halloween is just around the corner. And I want to reiterate, especially to young people, that the Marion County Public Health Department is recommending residents avoid face-to-face trick-or-treating. Avoid haunted houses and indoor parties. I know that missing out on trick-or-treating and Halloween get-togethers is just another disappointment in a year full of disappointments. But please keep this in mind. These are precautions that you can take to protect your health, the health of your family, and the health of your neighbors, and ultimately the overall health and well-being of our community. And I would suggest that that is worth more than a party or a bag of candy. It's worth taking the time to get creative, figuring out how how you can celebrate virtually. And ensuring that if you are going to be around people, that you're keeping your masks up and on. One of the biggest challenges of the COVID era remains putting our neighbor's health ahead of our own comfort. As mayor, I cannot make anyone do that. But I can and I will ask that you put your neighbor's health ahead of your own comfort. And I'm asking every resident of the city of Indianapolis, every resident who loves their city, to do exactly that, to not become complacent, to not allow yourself to be lax with these restrictions, but instead be mindful of the things that you can do each and every day to stop the spread of this virus any further than it already is. So I would like now to pass things over to my partner, Dr. Virginia Caine of the Marion County Public Health Department, who, as she does so eloquently when we have these conferences, she's going to walk us through the current data and give us an idea about the current trends. Dr. Caine?
You know, we're getting into the fall season. And because of that fall season, we have to always remember that we have the influenza cases on the horizon. And it is so important that we have a united front, all of us in this community, to promote public health in our community and to protect our loved ones and our friends. So I also, before I give my update related to COVID-19, please join us. The mayor and I in our Sleeve Up campaign, where everyone is encouraged to get your flu shot 6 months and older. So sleeve up, everyone. So that's so critical. Mask up, lather up, and sleeve up in order to make a difference for our community and so healthy. So if I could have my presentation, please. One of the things is that it's been challenging when we've looked across the country and we see other locations and communities with their COVID-19 cases expanding significantly. And if I can have that first slide, the next slide, Taylor. Are we able to make it larger? I only have one slide on the screen. Thank you. So when we look at the number of Indianapolis, Marion County residents who are positive for COVID-19. You know, our gold standard was to try to reach 5% or below, which would significantly say our community spread is declining. That you will see that since the beginning of September the 14th, where we had a little bit less than a 5% positivity rate, we have essentially almost been plateaued, where we went up to maybe 5.5% one day in early October. But as you can see, we've gradually come back down to 5.1%. And remember, we stated there are two standards that we look at to determine how healthy this community is in terms of community spread. The number one criteria of 5% positivity or less. But the other, as I will highlight a little bit later in my presentation, you have to also look at the total number of newly confirmed cases a day. And they have to be 35 or less daily cases on a 7-day average. So, but if you can see in that small corner, of this graph, you can see how we were really, really high at the beginning in April and May, and see how our positivity rate has dropped down dramatically. We were at 11% when we had our second peak back in right after July the 4th. And so we've gradually have come down. Next slide. This slide, I really wanted to highlight, so I really wanted to give you a good idea about how this epidemic looked as a whole. So if you see, facing the graph on the left-hand side, that we were in the positivity rate of in the 20% for a significant time, April and May. And when the mayor put in place all of the interventions, shelter in place, reducing in-room dining in restaurants, closing other entities significantly, you can see how that positivity rate dropped dramatically in the month of June, right after our Marion County Stage 4. But we again began to have a second peak, and we saw our numbers rising again. And so Mayor Hogsett quickly put in new restrictions. And you can see now our positivity rate is slowly coming down, not as rapid as we would like, but we're still slowly trending downward, our plateauing. So get off that plateau there and really dig in hard, because we wanna reach below 35, averaging 35 cases a day to really extend the good infection control throughout the community. And as you can see here, we're just going through almost October the 7th with our positivity rate of 5.1%. Next slide. Now, this is have been a major concern for us. So you can see how in early September, for the first 3 weeks in September, we were doing fantastic. In terms of our newly confirmed cases, we were sort of plateauing and we were averaging 100 cases per day. We dropped down to like about maybe 84, 85 cases a day. But recently, just in the last 2 weeks only, we have started to see a slow increase in our newly confirmed cases. And so we had reached 133 cases around by October the 10th. So this is something that we've got to be very aggressive about. What do I mean by aggression? It means that we really have to do a good job of wearing our masks and doing our social distancing of 6 feet and washing our hands, and definitely be very cautious. If you're feeling ill, don't go to work. And make sure that you're getting yourself checked out and practice good infection control within your homes or wherever you reside. Next slide. Our ED visits in the emergency rooms with COVID-19 symptoms are slowly creeping up. Now, back in early September, we were averaging about 15 visits per day of people having COVID-19-like symptoms. And we've kept that steady plateau number. And so just recently, we've gone up to about 25 more cases of patients with ED visits. So where we were somewhere ranging between 15 and 20 cases per day, we've gone up by maybe an additional 5 more patients a day with COVID-19 like symptoms. So we have to cautiously keep on monitoring those visits with those symptoms. Next slide. Our first time hospital admissions for persons with COVID-19, we're also seeing a percentage of those hospital admissions for persons with COVID positive 19 go up. And so early September, mid-September, we were seeing about maybe 5 hospital admissions a day. We've gone up now to about 3 more hospital admissions a day than early September. So maybe 5 people would be hospitalized for COVID-19. We're a little between 8 and 9 more cases. So 3 more cases, the 4 more cases of COVID-19 hospital admissions is not that bad. It's less than a 5 number of cases daily per day. But it is something for us to monitor and be very cautious about. Next slide. And as you see, our deaths have been primarily plateaued, where we're experiencing less than 2 deaths a day, and many times we don't even have 1 death a day. But today, I believe, for the first time from yesterday, we experienced 2 deaths, but where we had practically had almost no deaths for almost a 2-week time frame. Next slide. So everybody's always excited about how they fare based on your age and what's happening with your age group, your generation, as we look at who's being affected with the COVID-19 cases. And so let's start out with our most experienced golden year residents. And that is, at the start of this epidemic, we had nearly 40% in March consist of patients who were over the age of 60 who were experiencing COVID-19. Over 40%. Fast forward now to the end of September, and you see that seniors now make only 11% of the new COVID-19 cases, just 11%. But the group that makes the largest number of COVID cases continues to be our 20 to 39-year-old group that make up about almost 45% of the total COVID-19 cases. So a much younger generation is continuing to experience the largest number of COVID cases that we have. And so as a result, when we look at our 0 to 19 years of age individuals, we will see that from 0 to 19, we have now reached nearly almost 20% of our COVID-19 cases that are carrying, but astonishingly, it still appears that the majority of those cases are more likely to be 18 and 19 years of age, and less so from K through 12. But still, all of those age groups are rising considerably, with the exceptions recently of some. But good news I want to just highlight and reiterate what Mayor Hogsett is saying about what a fantastic job our school systems, our universities, our elementary schools, and all of the teachers, principals, the students themselves, the additional help that's going on in our school systems. So just very grateful about that. So if I have the next slide, I want to take this time and give a update about what's happening in regard to the school system. And let me just thank, I want to thank Dr. Brian Dixon from Regan Scrief Institute and the Indiana Fairbanks School of Public Health, who has helped to produce these particular data in terms of the schools. So now what's remarkable about these COVID plus cases through October the 9th, 2020, ages 0 to 17, if you can understand this slide, The darker red line shows that in August, we had reached maybe averaging 15 cases a day, but we had slowly stopped and see the significant decline in the number of just cases, all of our 0 to 17 combined. And you can see that the low numbers of those cases dropped to only 10 cases a day, got down to almost 6 cases a day. Now, we've recently seen a little bump where it went back up, getting up a little bit closer to 15, but we feel it's also back down on a downward trend. That's a remarkable accomplishment. We have over 200 and some thousand children in our schools systems, and for us to have those few cases from all of the school systems, it shows that a considerable amount of effort, talent, a lot of expertise has taken place in the school systems. Now let's take a look at it if we broke it down by different grades so you can just see what's happening there. So if I can have the next slide. So let's look at our 0 to 4 year olds. And this is based on the 7-day moving average or who's positive. Do you look at this from August? We have experienced less than 3 cases a day, primarily just 2 cases a day from our 0 to 4 year old children who are in the school systems, okay? Or, and this is in schools and not in schools, so this includes everybody, just the cases in our community. Next grade, if I have the next slide. Now let's look at our 5 to 10 year olds. And so with the 5 to 10 year olds, you will see basically that they've been basically having on a 7-day average about 4 cases per day. And you saw a significant decline from August through almost through the end of September, where they dropped down almost to only 2 cases a day. Now we have seen a little recent bump where they came up to 6 cases for just a short 1 or 2 days, but again, it is now back down on the downward trend, and it's never gone over 6 cases per day for our grades 5 through 10. Okay, our next slide. 11 to 13 years of age. Again, look at that. Look at the remarkable numbers. We have not gotten over 4 cases for all 11 to 13 year of age children in our community. Look at that. So less than 4 cases per day on an average 7-day moving average. Now the one that gets a lot of discussion and attention, because the older you get, you're supposed to be able to transmit, be a much greater transmitter of infection. So let's look at our 14 to 17 year age group. Wow. This is our high school group, okay? The high school group, the 9th through the 12th graders. So you will see that at the beginning in August, they were experiencing on a 7-day moving average about 6 cases. Look how that dropped to less than 3 cases, and it's gone back up slightly, but not over 5 cases per day in our high schools. So all the high schools that we have, how many high schools do we have over 1,000 children participating in those schools? But you look at these numbers to highlight that we are holding steady. We're very stable. We are kicking it out of the park. You know, if you happen to be a sports person, understanding, looking at this data. Now, my last slide. And it's my wonderful new generational freshmen, college students. And look what happened. When they first started entering school, like in late August, look, we were seeing as many as 30 new cases a day on a daily basis. But oh my goodness, school administrators, your leadership, your staff, have what you've done and how well you have communicated to your students. Look at that remarkable drop from averaging over 30 cases a day. They're down to almost less than 15 cases of new cases of COVID-19 that are popping out. So while we may have one aspect of the community that we're continuing to see pockets of cases increase, we look like we have a safe and stable environment in our school systems, Mayor, and the rest of the public. I just want you to realize that and understand that. And so as a result of that, we're going to be monitoring this very carefully. Our hybrid models have worked that we put in place. Our cohorting that we had in place worked. Our masks that we're requiring the children and the faculty to wear worked, okay? The extra frequently touched disinfectant surfaces was great. Our ventilation systems that we improved in the schools was fantastic. And then just the education, and education has just been tremendous and wonderful. And so we look to see how to expand on this, okay, to continue to make progress. And so we may have some new recommendations that may be coming out shortly in the future. Thank you, Mayor. That's it.
Great. As always, what we'll do now is we'll call upon people. If you put your name and outlet into the Q&A chat box, we will call upon you, unmute you, and you'll be able to ask your question of the group. First person up is Abdul Hakim Shabazz from Indy Politics.
Can you hear me, Mr. Mayor? Just a couple of questions. On the Halloween recommendations, are those recommendations or are those going to be like an executive order to avoid trick-or-treating haunted houses, or how is that going to work? And another question, I guess, for you and Dr. Caine, is with the progress it looks like the city's been making on its numbers, does that mean that bars can actually start to stay open like a half hour or an hour later, or is that still going to be closing at midnight?
You know, out of deference to Dr. Caine, I'm going to have her answer both of your questions, Abdul.
Okay. So let me see, Abdul. I remember about the bars and what have you. So our numbers have looked really great with the kids in the school systems and the universities. Unfortunately, when we're looking at our community at large, we're seeing a significant, steady increase in our community spread in the community. And we don't want to lose all that good work. So no, we're going to keep the bars and the restaurants closing at 12 o'clock. And remind me what that your other question was.
My first question was, will be any sort of executive order or directive regarding Halloween and trick-or-treating in particular, or is it just going to be a recommendation that you don't do it face-to-face?
So I think we had a strong recommendations currently right now.
Yeah, Abdul, this is Paul Babcock, and I just wanted to chime in on Dr. Caine's response about Halloween. We put out recommendations following CDC guidelines that listed the risk of the activity, and so it went from basically, you know, okay, safe, to strongly discouraged due to COVID-19 transmission possibilities. And so that document is out there for people to look at. And we can make it available again for you to put up on your website and share with your followers so that people know what's safe, as well as what is a little bit more risky to be involved when it comes to Halloween.
Great. Our next question is from Russ McQuaid at Fox 59.
And for you, Dr. Caine, as you mentioned, it seems like there are at least three trends, newly confirmed cases, ED visits, and hospital admissions that stubbornly look like they are trending up. And at the end of your comments, you mentioned some new recommendations. So what I would ask is, if it looks like these are trending up, why not roll back some of the openings and restrictions just to be safe? Or two, can you give us some sort of an idea of what you are considering when you talk about some new recommendations?
So Russ, that's a really great point. You know, this is a tough act, it's a tough challenge, and thank God the mayor has to make the decisions, mayor. But it's a balancing act with trying to balance from an economic standpoint our businesses versus significant risk to our community where we lose ground in terms of what we're doing. And so we are not going to move back just yet. We would like to monitor maybe 1 to 2 more weeks to get a feel for, is this a trend that's going to continue? Albeit it's slowly increasing, but we really are keeping our eye on it. And before we make that decision. So we want to at least get another whole full good week of looking at the data, and possibly 2, before we put some more restrictions in place. And we're hoping we won't have to do that.
And Dr. Caine, I want to add something as well. Remember, we've discussed that right now we're trying to figure out where some of these new cases are coming from, because the universities across the state of Indiana are doing a significant amount of testing, but from what we understand, students still list their home address as Marion County, and that case gets tracked back to here. And so as we're trying to sort through that data, Russ, we're optimistic, but also cautious, and very much, you know, wanting to follow what the evidence suggests.
Russ, I'd simply add to what Dr. Caine and Paul have indicated. You know, Dr. Caine's right. You know, there are some trends that concern us, but overall, as has been reported, our positivity rate continues to decline. But at the end of the day, Russ, data and science are going to dictate our decisions and the recommendations that Dr. Caine proposes. And we don't want to loosen restrictions too soon, because we do have reason to believe that might drive other metrics upward. The ones that are improving, we don't want to drive them up. So while we remain open to difficult decisions that might lie ahead, for right now, we're keeping the restrictions that we have in place because they are working in many ways. I am concerned about ED visits. I am concerned about hospital admissions. But overall, the restrictions that we have in place, we have reason to believe that they are working, and that's why we implore all residents to double down and make sure that just because it's fall break, or just because we've got Halloween coming up, or we have other events on the calendar, we want things to trend, continue in the right direction. So
our next question is from Erica Heron at the Indy Star.
Hi, Dr. Caine. You've said before that high school students can't go back to full-time in-person instruction until we get down to that 35, you know, average case per day kind of threshold. Are you standing by that? And do you still expect us to hit that, I think before you had said maybe November 1 or November.
You're a little scary because I'm concerned that you might be reading my mind here. So we also try to look at the data and see what's happening based on what we have put in place. And so we do have the ability to change our minds or adjust our recommendations accordingly. So one of the things we're looking at now is whether we will keep that same strict criteria for us to allow our high school students to go back in person, since our numbers are looking so good and the school systems are doing such a wonderful job. So that is something that we will be looking into very carefully in the next week in terms of whether we will make that recommendation and change our criteria in order to allow high school students to go to school in person.
Great. Our next question is from Dave Lindquist at the Indy Star.
Thank you. The October 2nd Halloween guidelines mentioned increased police presence from 6 to 8 p.m. on Saturday the 31st. I'm guessing the city isn't announcing official trick-or-treating hours, even if people are modifying their trick-or-treating. But is that the time window where you expect people to be out and not out past 8?
So we're going to continue to have our public health order in place when it comes to people being out and about. That doesn't necessarily impact, you know, things going on during the daytime, but we still want to keep folks strictly there and closed at midnight, obviously, because later on it goes, people end up getting more likely to expose themselves to COVID.
Paul, I think what David was actually referencing was not the public health orders regarding bars and restaurants, but was actually about trick-or-treating hours. Dave, to your point, yes, you're right. Because we are discouraging trick-or-treating, there will not be sort of set hours, but we've set those public safety guidelines in place so that if neighborhoods are coming up with innovative and safe ways to be able to have people out enjoying the holiday from a distance, and with those guidelines in place, we'll ensure that there are public safety entities out monitoring the neighborhoods as well. Our next question is from Tom Healy at Indy Midtown Magazine.
Thank you. Dr. Caine, your office's most recent situation report continued this trend of showing data that the most affected populations are African-American and Latinx communities. At the last get-together here a couple of weeks ago, you said that you and the mayor were going to do some outreach to Hispanic Coalition and the Pacific Islander community and African-American community. I wonder if you could give any follow-up on how those meetings went and what steps are being taken to try to minimize the effects on these highly affected communities.
So I thought that the meeting went well with the Latino organization. Mayor Hogsett participated and Mr. Paul Babcock participated at that time when he was the director of public safety. And they outlined about, I would like to say, maybe about 10 or 12 issues that I believe were very critical in terms of really trying to combat the increase of COVID-19 in our Latino communication. One of the issues was they wanted to see a testing site for all of the Marion County Health Department driving testing sites for COVID-19 that have the registration in Spanish, as well as having the ability, once they did the registration, being able to receive the results back in Spanish as opposed to English. And so we're currently in the process of doing that. We ran into a little challenges where I guess there are different Spanish translations that occur in our community because we have people from so many different aspects, from the Latinx populations, whether you're Puerto Rico, from Colombia, or Mexico. So, but we really think we're very close to making that happen. And so we already had a call center where you could call and do your registration by phone, speaking to a Spanish-speaking person, and they would do their registration for you. But, you know, a lot of people are maybe uncomfortable about that, and they would like to be able to do the registration themselves and receive the information related to that. Some of the other issues pertain to their ability to receive resource funding to do community outreach and education. And so we're looking to try to get a feel and flavor for what amount of money would be required in order to do that community outreach. Talk with an organization just recently this week where we have a number of our Latino population may be multi-generational. So there may be a larger number of individuals living or residing in a household based on the capacity of the space or the apartment. And so they don't always have the luxury that when they are positive, that they can self-quarantine someplace else. Because there's so many people there, they really can't do 6 feet social distancing. So we're even toyed trying to see if we can find a facility or location where we could allow them to self-quarantine for the 14 days without being a financial burden related to that particular patient population. And so a number of issues, like one other thing, a lot of the Latino populations who are employed may state that they report that they're positive, show their employer the documentation that they're positive, and say that they have to be quarantined for 14 days, and the employer in the next couple of days will fire that employee. And so a lot of the employees don't know what their rights are. And so, but it hampers our epidemic because then they stop telling their employers that they're positive, because they may be the only breadwinner in the family, and so they can't afford to lose their job. And so they feel bad about maybe going to work with their other colleagues knowing that they're infected. So we've got to figure out how to reach those employers to stop that illegal act in terms of what they're doing with our special racial and ethnic populations that have special challenges that others may not have. We're seeing an increase in our Burmese population. We're doing outreach with the Burmese leadership related to that and talking about how we can work greater with the faith-based organizations. The same is the case with our African-American populations. And then working with groups such as Urban League for the African community, working with the Minority Health Coalition of Marion County, working with our Hispanic Coalition of Marion County, La Plaza. There's so many Hispanics Against Domestic Violence. There's just so many different organizations that we're looking to work with and help to do the education and a campaign based on their languages.
Great. Our next question is from Russ Dodge at WITT.
Good afternoon, everybody. I want to do the restaurants start moving more inside if they don't have heat lamps. So what accommodations are being made as far as the number of people that they will be allowed to accommodate? Will there be any changes? And what are you doing to try and assist the restaurants in that area?
Yeah, I'd throw that to maybe Thomas Cook, who's with us, to bring Russ up to date with our help grant program.
Yeah, no, thank you, Mayor. So we have actually two different programs that were announced in the last few weeks to assist essentially hospitality businesses, restaurants, bars, entertainment venues. The first actually went live yesterday and is the HELP grant. It's up to $25,000 for rent and mortgage assistance. Not exactly speaking to your question, although I want to mention it because if you go to the Indy Chambers Rapid Response Hub, we still have capacity for that program. I know applications have been rolling in all day long. I think in applications alone yesterday, we had more than $4 or $5 million worth of applications that were made. And we do expect that that program will unfortunately, or fortunately, depending upon how you think about it, hit capacity sometime in the next few days, if not by early next week. The second program we launched, which speaks directly to your question, is a winter contingency assistance program. We don't actually have a name for it yet. So that's a description, not an actual title. But we will be announcing soon details for a program that I think is set to go live on November 1st, where the same grouping of businesses, restaurants, bars, entertainment venues, will be able to seek up to $2,500 worth of reimbursement for heaters, for canopies, for additional tables and chairs. And that's intended to help with the financial cost. From a bureaucratic standpoint, we're continuing to run our Dine Out program, which has been assisting businesses in setting up temporary outdoor seating in excess of what they may have been previously permitted to have. In addition, the state has been working with us to have that expanded outdoor capacity continue for those places with alcohol licenses. So we're currently looking into things like whether there's a size and scope in which permitting is required for having heaters or other outdoor elements that may be necessary, but we're going to continue to do everything we can, both financially with the limited resources we have from the federal government, but also bureaucratically to make it as easy as possible for these businesses during a difficult time.
Great. Our next question is from Eric Berman at WIBC.
Hello, Mr. Mayor. Hello, Dr. Caine. Couple of questions. I'm sorry, one question, beg your pardon. Last time we got together, you talked about the Colts going much better even than you had anticipated, and they've, of course, increased their capacity since then. In the contact tracing that the county has done, have any of those linked back to Colts games, and do you see that capacity going up even further?
So we have not, looking at our contact tracing data, we have not seen any major significant cases arising from the Coach games, but we're probably just going to maintain the number of spectators at 12,500 for the Coach. We're not going to go higher to 15,000 that we had surmised a little bit earlier. So we're going to just remain at 12,500 spectators for right now.
And our last question is a follow-up from Tom Healy.
Thank you, Taylor. Caine, you had mentioned in responding to my previous question in passing that there were some challenges from individuals who had been diagnosed as having COVID, needed to quarantine, and then were then fired from their position. And you mentioned in passing that they didn't understand their rights and what the law is on that. And I got to say, I don't understand what their rights and what the law is on that. And I wondered if you could explain that.
So technically, because if someone has COVID-19, an employer does not have the right to fire them based on their medical condition of COVID-19.
And Tom, I want to add to that. This is Paul Babcock, interim CEO at Health and Hospital. There are two laws that protect folks. One was passed earlier in the year. It's called the Families First Coronavirus Relief Act. The Department of Labor actually has been updating the regulations around that And so that provides protections for individuals from wrongful termination. And then I think the Americans with Disabilities Act also provides protection through OSHA and other employment laws. And if you want, we can, you know, circle up and have a larger discussion about that offline just to help bring you up to speed.
Thank you so much for joining us for today's press conference. We will go ahead and plan to distribute both a copy of Dr. Caine's presentation as well as a copy of the memo that went out from the Marion County Public Health Department and the mayor's office regarding Halloween in just a few minutes. Thanks so much.